Hello, everyone. My name is Amin. I'm a graduate student at Columbia University, and together with Julian, I'm going to present our abstract in NeuroMatch 4 called Bayesian Neural Nets for Characterizing Neural Dynamics Across the Population. To give a quick bit of motivation, I'm including this figure from a recent paper by Professor Shenoy showing how the computation can happen through the population dynamics of the brain, and how the observed signals could correspond to a low-dimensional latent space, and the dynamics of the low-dimensional space can govern the observed signals. I've also included this figure from a very recent paper by Yuri et al., showing that by large-scale recordings, now we can make hypotheses that were not possible before. These two pieces of motivation calls for the need to develop models that generalize well across the population. C. elegans is used in neuroscience as a testbed for statistical models of neural data, predictive and generative models of neural data. Here I've included this figure from a paper by Professor Linderman developing a model called recurrence switching linear dynamical systems and providing insights about different linear pieces of neural dynamics that could be relevant observe behavior. So the assumptions that people usually make when developing dynamical models is the existence of a low-dimensional latent space, and different models overcome the challenge of capturing both private and shared components of neural observations, private to individual animals and shared across the animals, using model flexibility and stochasticity. But once the stochasticity introduced in the system, the inference algorithms become very specialized and require careful treatment. Here I've included a general formula for a discrete dynamical system. Usually we assume that the dynamics of the neurons at time t plus one is given by applying a transformation to the dynamics at time t and the input stimuli. This function could be stochastic or deterministic. Bayesian neural networks that are recently proposed, they treat the weights of a neural network as random variables instead of just constant numbers. And they provide a distribution over all the functions that match the input data. So the way that they model the problem is that they assume a prior distribution over the weights of a neural network, and then the output of the neural network is given using an observation distribution. In the inference part, we infer a posterior distribution over the weights of this neural network, given all the data, and then based on this inferred posterior, we can make predictions about the new data points. BNNs are great because they allow for flexibility and stochasticity at the same time. We also have a lot of generic inference algorithms developed in the ML community. However, approximate inference usually leads to inexpressive posteriors in BNNs, and the exact posterior inference is not possible using MCMC methods in a very high dimensional setting. With this, I'll hand it over to my collaborator, Julian.
So to circumvent the issues Amin just described, we developed a novel inference method that consists in jointly learning, encoding and decoding deterministic layers, as well as performing inference on Bayesian layers in the low dimensional space. So our network typically looks like this. So we have an encoding deterministic layers followed by Bayesian layers followed by decoding deterministic layers to reconstruct the output. And to perform inference here, we perform alternate inference where we first use MCMC or variants such as no-U-turn sampling or Hamiltonian Monte Carlo to draw samples from the posterior distribution over the Bayesian layer parameters. And then we perform gradient descent to update and learn the encoding and decoding deterministic weights, where the loss we optimize is the sum of squares over all samples and all data points. So let's look at the results. So what we did is, we tried to infer the neural activity of C. elegans worms at time t plus one given activity and stimulus at time t. And here we're showing the reconstructed traces in red, blue, and green for three types of neurons, sensory, inter, and motor neurons. And the true trace is in black. And we're showing it for our method, the hybrid BNN, the first column, then a deterministic neural net that has the exact same architecture as our method. And then OSRDS, which is a state-of-the-art method for modeling this type of neural trajectories. And so what we see, if we look at our prediction, is that the flexibility of the network leads to a good prediction. And then the uncertainty actually varies with stimulus and varies with the input. So it's the uncertainty associated to our posterior distribution is highly input dependent. So now more quantitatively here, the first figure, we computed the correlations between the true and the reconstructed traces for the hybrid BNN and for RSLDS, and we scatterplotted them. And we see that RSLDS is overall doing better at prediction. Now the second box consists in box plots of the z-scores of the true trajectory given, you know, the posterior mean and variance. And we see that when the network is overconfident, the z-score is gonna have large variance. So our network here is too confident, whereas RSLDS is not, because you know, as we've seen in the previous plot, the variance is very large for RSLDS. So, however, our network, you know, we've seen that first the variance is input dependent, so the uncertainty is meaningful here. And then our network allows to explicitly perform this trade-off between accuracy and uncertainty by looking at the posterior over weights and the posterior over observation noise. And finally, it's important to note that when doing RSLDS here, we actually trained on the test worms to get the latent states before generating the sample. So it's not fully test data for RSLDS. Now, finally, our model allows to generate trajectories and to explore, you know, different states of the trajectory. So for example, here on the first line, we generated neural trajectories for these 15 neurons here. And we see the sample trajectory and mean and variance of our distribution. And we've simulated long lasting stimulus here, which is not accessible in the data. And what we see is that the neuron activity typically converge very fast for the green and pink stimulus here, whereas the yellow one here, which is NaCl, actually excites the neuron on the long term. So there's a lot of very exciting thing about these models, and we hope that you're going to be excited about it too. And thank you very much for listening.